Good morning, Oak Hill. We are so thankful to have you here this morning on Pastor Appreciation. It runs the whole month of October, and we always choose the first Sunday in October to recognize it. No matter how many times I get up here, I am nervous. Ooh. Deep breath. Okay, so I would like for the following people to come up front. I need Hunter and Bailey, Bryant and Morgan, and Emma, and Cheryl, and of course, Brother Ray. Okay, now I get to weave through because I didn't pull the presents out before I caught them all up here. Okay, so I'm going to give you guys this one. You guys this one. And don't worry about the Florida Georgia colors. I didn't realize it till this morning. Nothing intentional. You guys can go ahead and open those because I know everybody in the church is wondering what in the world is in your bag. It's not Florida Georgia tickets. The church doesn't have that much money. Yeah, we can't do that. So they got a little kind of snack treat, a gift card to Olive Garden, and a gift set from Bath & Body Works. So we'll do Emma next. And I know Emma hates being in the spotlight, so if you hurry, it'll move on to somebody else. So Emma got some Bath & Body Works that I think a little bird told me was her favorite. And then a shirt and a tote bag that has all of her pigs' names on it. All right. So Miss Shug's bag looks a little small, but it packs a big punch. Okay, so we gave Miss Shug a gift certificate to Brada Studios, and the church is covering the sitting fee and enough money to get pictures in print or digital, whichever way you want it. And it can also go if you want them to go to your house and take your pictures, whatever you want to do. So. And it will include up to 10 people. So if there's seven or so of us that you want to include, we'll, you know. Yeah. Okay, Brother Ray. You can dive on in. Okay, so this is just a small part of your gift. No, we know better. Inside that book are pictures from this year for different things and letters from different people that they wrote to you. Also in the back are extra pages for all of the pictures that the kids drew you while you were in quarantine and we were in quarantine. You can put them in that book and keep everything safe and secure. The other side to your gift is it's not going to be here till about November, partly because I didn't realize how long it was going to take to make it. And the other part is thanks to COVID. I mean, how many times has COVID messed something up? We also got you a 1960 Spurgeon Study Bible that is going to be handmade, and it'll be black and red, and in silver have your name on the front. So inside that Bible is notes from Charles Spurgeon's sermons, along with it being a Bible. So that's what you got coming as soon as it gets here, which is not fast enough for me. So the month of October being Pastor Appreciation, as most of us do, we pray for our pastor and our team that leads our youth. There's been a lot of things this year with death and just sorrow. So just remember every day to lift everybody up in prayers, and we appreciate all that you guys do for us here at Oak Hill, and we hope you have a great day and a great meal in the back, because I've already seen you can't have it chicken, but they got you something else. We did take care of him. We're not going to make him eat fried chicken because he can't. So if anybody sees him with any, you got to go slap it out of his hand. Okay? We love y'all, and thank you, Oak Hill.
They must be seeing my other Bible. It's about wore out. I was going to have this one sent off. They shaved. They could. They got a process. They shaved the edges and rebind it. And you hate to throw your notes away. You know, everybody, you're writing your Bible, you hate to throw your notes away. But a thank you, church. This is an easy church to pastor. And I really appreciate it and appreciate you folks. And this community appreciates you. And it's always good whenever you're somewhere and people say, oh, yeah, Oak Hill, yeah, that's good. That's good. So thank you, church. It's been a different year this year, but the Lord knew it, and he's got us all in the right places as we work. So we appreciate you. Announcements real quick. Trina does a bulletin, and it's like looking at something. It's hard to look at, ain't it, Trina? Is that what you told me? She said she's got all these pictures, and I have to see a black line, so I have to look at all the pictures. Oh, this sheet? No, this is the only one I have. Oh, it's up here on this side. Oh, yeah. See, this is how I have to read it, because I get sidetracked. Thank you, Trina. I get sidetracked. Meal after church this morning in honor of Pastor Appreciation. Everybody, please stay. Please start bringing candy for the treat bags for the fall festival. Start bringing candy. Wednesday night workers' meal, October the 11th, after the AM service. Sign up in the hallway. Includes any Sunday school teachers that were missed as well. If you couldn't come, please come be part of that one. Also, homecoming is October the 25th, 2020. And fall festival is the 28th at County Line Farm up in town on Knight Avenue at Brother Johnny's farm. Also, most of you already know, but Brother Roger went home to be with Jesus Friday and about 1:30-ish. And we had talked a couple times in a week. You guys were talking to him as well. He was ready. He was ready. This old world had grown weary to him. And, you know, that's the way I believe that God lets us grieve, is so that we long for things over there. These bodies break down, so we long to be. So the funeral and the viewing. The viewing will be here tomorrow. It's a memorial service, so it'll be at 3. The family will be taking visitors at 3 to 4. And the funeral memorial service will be at 4 o'clock. And then we'll be feeding the family afterwards. So if anybody's bringing anything, the desserts are made already, but any side dishes that you're bringing, have them here at 3 so that they can have it set up back here. All the meat will be supplied. But love on Miss Cindy and them as they come, and their family and their extended families. And it's good to see all of them loving on each other Friday. Got Brother Roger's seat over here. If you haven't seen, Peyton come put a little piece of paper in the seat. And said, they love you, Brother Roger. I hope you're having fun in heaven. And the seat's over there. So we'll do that today. And just thank the Lord that heaven's real. And one of ours isn't suffering today. But it's darker today without him. So let's remember him in prayer. Remember family in prayer. Any more announcements? Are there any prayer requests we need to add? Ethan Pritchett. God bless her heart. Amen. Any others? Any other? Any unspoken this morning? Amen. We went over 100 in Sunday school today, and that was kind of what we've been working for since COVID hit. I know some people are still social distant, and that's good. Listen, if you're worried, listen, by all means, please stay home, be safe. But we had 109 this morning, so we had got up to about 140 or so at times, so we're getting back to our our stride. So it's good to see. Appreciate all the folks coming. Don't forget, we have a coffee bar in the mornings before Sunday school. So if you'd like to come get coffee, there's all kind of coffees back here in the back. And Miss Heyman is heading that up. So, and she has sweet rolls back there for everybody that likes things like that. Amen. Anybody else before we pray? Well, let's pray. Lord, thank you for this time together for our church and our church people. Lord, we're Lord, just glad to be at a place, Lord, we can come and worship you with folks that we enjoy being with. And God, we are sorry today and sad that we've lost one of ours this weekend. But God, thank you for welcoming him home, and God, him not being in pain any longer. I'm thankful, God, that nobody has to take him to any chemo treatments this week. Lord, that Miss Cindy can rest. I pray, Lord, you'll keep her close to you, keep her spirits up, Lord. And as we love on her, God, I pray that she comes to terms with her new life now. And I just pray, God, for the family around her as they love on her, Lord. Just give them peace now that passes all understanding. For all the others, for the young man that accidentally shot himself, Lord, we just pray you'll bless that family and just keep them close and be close to them now. For all the sick, the sin sick in our community, there's so many. And just pray, God, you'll bless them and take care of folks. Help us, Lord, to be a church where people want to come to hear the word, to be loved on. So, God, help us and grow us and continue to make this healing station in this community. Lord, we love you and we thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. We ask everyone to stand with us this morning. Help us worship together. Is your mic on, Brother Ray? He's our bass. He sings bass for us, so we gotta have him.
with you, God. We just thank you for his grace, his mercy. And God, just continue to be with us, Lord. Just strengthen us as only you can, Lord. Lord, we just thank you for this day. Lord, we just thank you for this church. Lord, we just come to you right now, Lord. Just give you praise and honor for all you are and what you mean to us, Lord. You loved us first. Thank you. Lord, just take this time and offer right now, Lord. Just use it. And use it for one purpose only, Lord. We give you honor and praise and glory that you deserve. Lord, just give us wisdom to be good stewards of this. Lord, we just thank you and love you and pray for all these things. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living home. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and feel the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your
Well, amen. Take your Bibles with me, if you would. Turn to John chapter 2. John chapter 2. John chapter 2, verse 23. John chapter 2, verse 23. Over the past couple of weeks, I've been studying and preaching. One question that has always alarmed me over the years is where do people go whenever they profess salvation and then at some point are no longer go to church? It's always struck me as odd that if somebody truly believes that there's a God in heaven and has saved them from their sins, and that at some point they're going to heaven when they die, why on earth would they stop serving? I've never understood how somebody that could believe that there's a God in heaven who made the heavens and the earth, that created everything that is, that ever will be, that ever has been, that could serve God and at some point stop. That's been something I have studied. What's the thinking? What's somebody's thinking that happens that way? And I'm going to tell you today, I believe, and we're going to talk about this, and because I want us to understand, I believe that there's a lot of people in a place like this. But I believe there's a lot of people. I made these two words a statement last week, but I believe there's a lot of people that are lost believers, that are lost believers, that they believe that there's a God. They believe that he had a son named Jesus. They believe that he died on the cross for their sins. They believe all this stuff, but they've never trusted him and put their faith in him to save them. Never have. Believe all the stuff, but never put their faith and trust in Christ Jesus. You say, well, brother, how do you know? How do you know difference? I'm glad you asked. We're going to get into that in just a minute, because I think that there's certain attributes, there's certain things, certain flags that pop up in the life of a person who is a Christian. Now, listen, can I tell you, as a Christian, you're going to suffer through and go through problems just like everybody else. I'm going to tell you, just because you're a Christian doesn't mean that you're immune to all the problems that come into life. Then all of a sudden, all your children are going to be happy and everybody's going to be great. That's not the way it works. Listen, we're going to go through things on this side, and we're tested by God. And I believe that we're tested so that we can grow closer. We can go more like God. If I was an athlete and I was working out, I'd want to start with a little bit of weight and work my way up. That's why a lot of times as Christians, we go through small issues and small problems. We deal with smaller things because down the road, there's bigger things. There's bigger things, and we have to deal with things as we go and as we grow, as we mature. And a Christian will notice that in their life. They'll notice how they're growing. They'll see things in their life as they grow. It ought to excite you that you can see yourself grow. You ought to be excited that the Lord chastises you. That means you're one of his. It ought to excite you that you recognize that you're not the same this year as you were 3 or 4 years ago, that you're growing or maybe sliding back. Those things ought to excite you, because, I mean, really, the real answer to that is you know then that you're part of a family. You're part of the kingdom of God. And see, that ought to excite you. I know there's people today that you're thinking about right now that was in church at one time, now they're not in church. And I've been to 28 years, August 29, 1992, got saved. 28 years of being a Christian, I can look back and count pages and pages of people that were once in church that are no longer in church. I don't know why. And I think it's because the vast majority of them are lost. Come on now, you like or don't it? That's just the way it is. I believe Lobbs is lost. Listen, if I knew that the Creator God was who He said He was, you wouldn't have a problem finding me down there at God's house. The Bible talks about the fear of God as the beginning of understanding. And we begin to recognize who God is by knowing that, hey, listen, there ought to be a little fear when we think about the things of God. I'm not saved because I work. I do work because I'm saved. And I'm going to tell you something else that maybe some people have a hard time coming to grips with is works isn't salvation. A lot of people think that if they do a lot of stuff that somehow or another disproves that they're saved. Can I tell you, nothing on the outside of you, no act you do, nothing on the outside of you will ever prove that you're saved. You all right? There's no performance you can put on. Nothing will ever happen that you can work up that will prove anything to this world that you are saved. You know that you're saved. God knows that you're part of the family because things begin to happen on the inside of you. You begin to evolve, if you will, because it's not overnight. You begin to change. Things begin to happen. Over the past several weeks, months, whatever, we've seen a lot of things. I'm glad today I'm this far down the road in Christianity because in my maturing in the faith, because I would have acted differently 10 years ago to some things. Everybody agree with that? I mean, you go through things, you're glad that you're where you are today because you see, you know, that excites me because it tells me above all else that I'm part of the kingdom of heaven, that I'm growing, and I'm growing because I'm a Christian. Some of you say, well, sometimes I feel bad when I'm not in church. I know I should be there, and it bothers me. And I know I need to be because I remember what it felt like. I remember to be in God's house. Listen, you ought to be thankful for that chastisement. You ought to be thankful that the Holy Spirit of God whips you when you're not doing what you're supposed to do. Because only your family whips you. If anybody else does it, it's called assault. You can get a lot of money. It's called assault. But look here with me. John chapter 2, verse 23. Watch what Jesus says about this. John chapter 2, verse 23 says this. And when he was in Jerusalem, at the Passover, in the feast day, underline this word, many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. Many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. 24, but Jesus did not commit himself to them because he knew all men. Verse 25, and needed not that any should testify of man, for he knew what was in man. You know, I've read that over years, heard it preached, read past it, and I'm thankful that there's so much to learn in Scripture. If you look up, there's two words there. One was the word believe in verse 23, and in verse 24, you'll find the word commit. They mean the exact same thing. If you look them up in the Greek, you'll find out in your Strong's Concordance, in the Greek New Testament, where it's broken down, 4100 is its Strong's number. It means simply this, to have faith in, to put trust in. It means to have faith in or put trust in. Now, look what happened. So, in the feast day, many had trust in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. But Jesus did not put trust in. Jesus did not put trust in those that were there. In other words, they might have believed on him, but he didn't believe in them. Now, take a minute. Because the word goes on to say, because he knew what was in man. He knew why they were doing what they were doing. You say, well, that's hard. I hear they were believing in him. Did you believe in God before you got saved? Yeah. Yeah. I believed in God before I got saved. I even thought that I was going to get to go to heaven because everybody around me was saved and I was good. I thought I was good. So I thought that that was salvation. I thought that if I was good and I believed in God, I believed that Jesus was who he said he was, that I got to go to heaven simply because I was good and I did good things. People believe that to be true. Sadly, it's preached and taught. You know, today, we got to understand that God knows what's inside you. God knows what motivates you to do what you do. God knows why we give that extra $10 in our tithes or give that extra $10 to the needy. He knows why we show up early to carry out our ministries or why we don't show up at all to carry them out. God knows why you do what you do. And could it be that God knows our hearts and what's really in there? Could it be that the troubles you're going through right now is not an outward assault by somebody, but an inward reflection of what's really in there? Listen, you're not handling very good how you're being treated because you may not be saved. Take a minute. I got to tell you the truth. There's been times in the past few months I ain't been treated very good. I've been called a liar and a coward the past couple of months. I just don't do that very good. What'd you do, Brother Ray? Nothing. What do you want me to do? Get in my truck and go over there? No. What I recognize that I may be dealing with lost people and that I'm a child of the King. And there's a certain way the child of the King ought to carry himself. Well, you should take up. No, I don't have to take up for myself. I don't have to take up for myself. I don't even have to explain it. Because I'm a child of the King. Listen, some of you going through some problems in your life right now, could it be that you don't know Christ? Could it be the way that you're reacting to issues in your life simply because you may not be saved? And some of you may be saved. You're still responding wrong. You're just not very mature. There's some people going through issues in their life or they're just not mature yet. And we look at them and say, that's how lost people act. Oh, well, could be immaturity. The thing is for you to know the difference. The thing is for you to pray through and for you to know the difference. You see, we as people have gotten to see where we are with God. How's your relationship right now? You see, I'm not the one that decides whether or not you're saved or lost. I don't check all the boxes when the rapture of the Lord takes place and say, listen, you take this crowd, but this crowd here, I'd check out. I mean, God don't ask me to do that. That's between you and Him. So how is your relationship with God? I mean, if you come back today, you'd go, right? And if you went and you stood before God today, would you be ashamed of yourself when you got there? Or would you be glad? How's your relationship? I can remember in high school not doing my homework. I'm sorry, Miss Griffin. Miss Griffin, she's a teacher. I hardly ever done homework. And listen, Chad, I knew what I had to do to pass. I was a C student at best, but I knew what I had to do. I should have been better at math with all the figuring I did to see what I had to do to pass. I was terrible at math. Book reports, loved them because I never had to write them. Teachers found out that I would do them oral. I'd do them, I'd stand up in front of class and talk about my book. I had no problem standing up talking about my book. And I love to read. Always make great grades in literature and things like that. Great grades. Easiest class ever. But boy, there was one teacher. She always sent homework. And we always had those pop tests in the mornings. I never studied. See, that for somebody that didn't study, that was poison. Every morning, she'd say, all right, get a sheet of paper out. It wasn't good morning. How y'all doing? How's your mom and them? What none of that? Take out a sheet of paper. First class of the day, take out a sheet of paper. And the feeling that went over me when I realized I was fitting to make a 20. Because it was five questions. I knew. It's like she knew what I did not know. And she'd ask those five questions. Just a terrible feeling. You know, I can remember in seventh grade, Mr. Haywood, he had all those little sayings on the wall, like it's your attitude and not your aptitude that determines your altitude. I'll never forget it. I got a good memory for stuff like that. But he told us to memorize the definition of science. You've heard me say this before. Well, I didn't think he was serious. I didn't study. Told you I didn't study. The next day, guess who was the only person in class that didn't memorize that thing? They go through the class and everybody's, Mr. Haywood's rough. You know, he had one bad leg and he walked like this, and I thought, he's going to kill me. He's going to kill me. And he went all around the room, people was giving a definition of science, they would say it. You got some ideas. Matt Miller, you know that definition? No, sir. He said, I have my mind. He said, if there was going to be one person that wouldn't take it seriously, it'd be you. He said, I'm about to give you something to help you remember. Got me a paddle. Oh, yeah. That back in the day, they didn't need anybody to go back there with them. And mamas and daddies knew that you did it. They didn't ask the teacher if they did something wrong. No, you did it. Teacher said, did it, you did it. The next day, science is a knowledge and theory dealing with things in nature and the universe concerning forces that create, shape, and form things. Listen, such knowledge is generally based on sound facts and reasoning obtained from experiments and careful study, thus developing factual, hypothetical, theoretical explanations and answers. Yeah. It just stuck there. Seventh grade. I could use that room for something else. You know, seventh grade. You know how bad I felt? The day before, whenever I was going around, they knew it. It's like, oh. You know how good I felt the next day going in, and I knew it? You know, I wonder what it's going to be like when we stand before God. There's going to be a crowd that, you know, the waivers, woo-hoo. There's going to be that crowd, I made it. I made it. You're going to realize that God's promise he made you was true. But there was a way you should have lived your life. And now there's people. There's people that's going to suffer through all eternity because you didn't live your life the way God told you to. Do you think that's not important? Do you understand that we're just not at a social event? That we're not just engaging in a social study, hoping that at some point at the end it comes out and everything's okay and everybody gets to go to heaven. No. Not everybody goes to heaven. We have an obligation to the people that live in this community to show them what Christians ought to be like. Our co-workers, you realize you at that job, God has blessed you and put you in that place so that you can show them what a Christian ought to be like. Jesus said he knew what was in man. You may be surprised people around you know what's in there too. You may be surprised people know, you know, that you can't take very much, that you blow up at hardly nothing, that you have tendencies to, you know, indulge in things that may not be godly, things of the flesh. You'd be surprised people know, and they watch it. Listen. If you do those things, don't be wearing a church t-shirt, okay? Don't be wearing a church t-shirt. I got a call this week. Some of our folks is showing out on Snapchat. Oak Hill Baptist Church. Yeah. You better know people see you. And if you don't know that God knows, Brother Ray does. Next time, I'm going to come see you. Because what we're trying to do here don't need to be denigrated by somebody wanting to live an ungodly life in an ungodly world. We as God's people have to be godly. We're the only thing they see. This is good stuff right here. So here's the thing. We said all the ugly. Boy, I'm like, oh, it's bad. No. If you're a Christian, let me tell you seven quick ways to please God. I mean, don't we want to know how to please our Creator? You don't have to learn to dance, right? Woohoo. Listen, you don't have to learn to do a backflip, Hunter. Woohoo. Listen, we don't have to learn to do, I don't ever have to be an athlete to be a Christian. Thank you, Jesus. I don't even have to know how to fish, Ethan. Listen, there's things I don't know how to do to go to heaven. Here's what I do need to be doing. And these things please God. These things let not only me know that I'm saved, but the world around me know that I'm saved. Chances are the people are going to start seeing these things in your life. They're going to recognize something about you, recognize you're a Christian. You won't even know it. You'll be a walking billboard for the kingdom, won't even know it. Because God will start changing you in ways. And listen, the goal is to be a light. To be a light. Watch this. Having faith pleases God. Having faith pleases God. What you mean by having faith? The Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, for without faith, it's impossible to please God. Meaning that you believe that when you pray and somebody's sick, you believe God will answer. Listen, it may take time. But I also have faith that God may heal them different than I think the healing ought to be. I'll tell you what I've been praying for, Brother Roger. I've been praying for however long I've been here. He's had cancer since I've been here. I've been praying God heal him and raise him up. God did. Hey, old boy got up Friday afternoon in heaven. Old boy got up in glory. Answered. Check. 100%. Hey, faith, man, I recognize that my idea of healing ain't the same as God's. That God's got a whole different idea of what healthy looks like. God's got a whole different idea about us trusting and having faith looks like. We think that if we come to church and do stuff and are signed up for everything, that somehow or another, that represents our faith. That represents our work. That has nothing to do with it. It just shows that you're tired. Okay? Secondly, praise the Lord. I'm moving on here. First one, having faith pleases God. Secondly, being spiritually minded pleases God. Turn to Galatians 6:8. Or if you want to. I'll have it. Galatians 6:8 says this. Let me read verse 7 with that. Because when we're spiritually minded, there's some things that show up, and it's not always outward. You see, listen, over the past couple of months, boy, I'm thankful I'm saved. You know, there's been so many funerals. There's been so much death and so much pain. And, man, it breaks my heart for people. And on the flip side, there's been so much meanness. And so much ugly. And through all of it, though, God is still God. You know, and I begin to recognize God's still seeing folks saved. God's still seeing. We had four saved. Listen, the ministries of your church have seen four people saved this week. Four people. Two people online. You know, Tuesday night, I asked them to send something to me. They did. Had two folks send me a letter. They got saved. They prayed, received Christ with me. Amen. We're going to be working with them folks in the next few weeks. Boy, that excites me. Hey, and Mr. Ricky Pitts ain't here to tell you today. I don't know if he was here Wednesday night. He accepted Christ this past Monday afternoon. He said, Brother Ray, he said, I have struggled for years just concerned and not knowing. He said, I look back. He said, I remember us all going up to the altar. At one time, he had a big revival. He said, but to be quite honest with you, nothing ever changed in my life. I don't hear God. None of those things, none of the things you say that we ought to be hearing from. He said, I've never seen any of those things. He said, I never had no desire to change them, unless I was down there at church. He said, I got thinking. I'll always remember this. He said, I got thinking. He's sitting in front of his truck, me and him. He said, I got thinking. It'd be too late when I get to hell. So you're right, Brother Ricky. You're right. Hey, Jerry J's parking lot. Old boy got saved. Old boy got saved. He told me, he said, you tell the church because I won't be there Sunday. You go ahead and tell them. They listening now. He said, but you go ahead and tell them, okay? He got eye surgery Tuesday. Monday or Tuesday. But y'all be praying for him. Hey, old boy got saved. Young man I've known his whole life got saved last Sunday. Hey, God's working. God's working in our midst. And listen, if you'll recognize that God is doing a work, listen, you'll be more pleased because you'll see God working. Do you realize that God's working in little ways too? God's doing all kind of things around you. Little things happen, you know, just little things. And God's lining up these little spots. And just to give you a 10-minute break, your children came home healthy from their work the other day. Your husband made it home from work. Your child got on that four-wheeler, that buggy, and went riding and came home safe. God's good. We forget that every single thing and every moment, every day is blessed by our Heavenly Father. Psalm 68:19 tells us that He loads our wagon every single day with a brand new set of blessings. Ain't that good? Because I'm going to save up my blessings. You ain't got to. You're going to get some more tomorrow. Hey, that's like knowing you get to go to a buffet every day. I'm going to eat whatever I want to today. Amen. So tomorrow, I don't have to save for tomorrow. Because I get whatever the next day. It's like you know, and over. Oh, that's good stuff. I better hurry. Not only be spiritually minded. Did I finish that? We're moving on. Having faith pleases God. Being spiritually minded pleases God. And thirdly, fearing God pleases God. Do you realize when we begin to get to the place in our life that we recognize that God holds us accountable for the way that we do it, the way that we say it, the way that we live it. The whole thing, God sees us. I was preaching a revival one time and I made this statement. Jesus sees us. The next day, there was a mom in the church had a little t-shirt making machine. She brought them to church and kids started putting the t-shirts on. Jesus sees us. Do you know Jesus sees you? I mean, how does that affect where you plan on spending the weekend? How does that affect how you'll be in indulging your flesh? If it don't matter, you probably ain't saved. Are you okay? I mean, if it don't matter, you probably ain't saved. The bottom line is listen, I want to be right in my Father's eyes, not this church. Listen, I don't have to explain anything to you guys. I know my Heavenly Father has a higher standard. Listen, not only should we fear God, but we should study and follow Jesus Christ's example. We ought to be doing what Jesus does. Number five, we ought to obey God. Colossians 3:20 says this. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. So young people, all the young people in here right now, it ain't just for kids. We see this verse is for children obeying their parents at the house. We're all children. David was called a child at 40 years old. I believe if your parents are still alive today, they're due honor and respect. They're due honor and respect. You know, my daddy, he put in he was going to sell my tractor. My tractor. Yeah, he comes out, I think I got that tractor sold. I said, he's got five farmalls, you know. I said, which one? He said, that orange one. I didn't know they had made a farm all in an orange. He said, no, that Kubota. I said, oh, my tractor. He said, yeah, I think we got it sold. We're going to get us another one. We means me. Yeah. He needs a 50 horse. Needs to be bigger. Mine's only a 36 horse. Needs to be bigger. So what you going to do? He kind of likes those with the cab, Jonathan, with the air conditioning. Hey, but I got news for you. It's daddy. And if he brought a man to my house tomorrow to sell my tractor, he can do it. Because it's daddy. Listen, how do we treat our people? How do we treat our folks? Young folks, how do you treat your parents? You may not agree with them. You Shoot, you may not even like them right now. But you better believe this. If you want to honor God with your life, you'll obey your parents. And people say, well, I don't know if I want to please God that much. You ought to want to. You ought to want to please God. You ought to want to be on God's good side. Kids, if you want to get on God's good side, obey your parents. Do what they ask you to do. And try to be what they ask you to be. I'm sorry, Emma. Sorry. Mama's going to hold that against you all week, isn't she? Gotcha. Anyway, how about this? Number six, do God's will. Galatians 1:10. Listen, we got all down. We're going to get this right here now. Galatians 1:10 says this. The Bible says we should do God's will. For do I now persuade men or God? Paul said, do I persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of God. Paul said, listen, I can choose to do one or two things. He said, I can please man or I can please God. He said, I'd rather please God. Because if I please man, I'm not going to be on God's good side. Because man's expectation about how I ought to be and what I ought to live is slanted, is curved by sin. God's idea about my service is completely different. You have to choose who you're going to serve. You have to choose. You have to decide if you're going to do God's will with your life or man's will with your life. I mean, when you get up every single day and you make plans for the future, and I'm not talking about just for this week, I'm talking about for the next 10, 15, 20 years. Some of us make choices that warp our service for years by what we do, the way we spend our free time, the way we spend our monies. We put ourselves in a spot to where we can't serve God the way we'd like to. Be careful. Do God's will. Find out if it's God's will, you know, for you to have that big, giant, pretty boat. I appreciate that boat y'all got me. I'm feeling bad already. But listen, find out what God's will is. I remember hearing people, had a guy one time, he had bought him a brand new boat. Well, the thing was, you know, bow's expensive. I had no idea a bow costs $1,000. Now, that ain't very much. You can buy them for a lot more money than that. But it was several years ago. He said, I bought me a new bow, $1,000. I said, you going hunting Saturday? He said, nope, got to work. I got to pay that bow off. He said, I get four Saturdays of overtime. I get that money, I can pay my bow off. I said, awesome. I said, when are you going to hunt? Sunday. He said, don't look at me like that. Listen. There's folks that check out in hunting season, and we see them after Christmas. You know it's true. And while we laugh at it, you wore lots of hunting. No, the truth is, you're not setting a very good precedence. Seriously, what we tell people by what we do is what's important. Can I just be honest with you? I know I'm a preacher, but nothing ought to interfere with our worship and our attendance at God's house. You one side, you the preacher. And I'm always going to preach it that way. But you ain't ever going to find me at the place where I say, you don't have to go all the time. I believe you ought to go every time. I believe it's good for us to be down at the house of God with the other believers. I believe it's good. I need to be down here on Wednesday nights. I need Wednesday nights. Man, I'm so glad we got Sunday night started back. Whew, I need Sunday nights. Everybody don't come back Sunday nights. Y'all must not need as much as I do, but I need it. Boy, I need Wednesday night. You see the crowd here Wednesday night? Praise the Lord. Folks recognize that they need it. I want to do God's will. God's got a word for me. God's got a word he wants to give me, and I might not get it unless I'm down at God's house. God's got something he wants to tell me. I need to be down at God's house. The seventh thing, seven ways to please God. I know. Praise the Lord, Brother Ray. This is the last one. But verse 7 says this. Give the sacrifice God wants. Look at Romans 12:1. Give the sacrifice God wants. You know, a lot of times we think if we can give money, we can give whatever to the church. Sapphira and Ananias thought they could give a piece of land and lie about what they gave. God knows what's on the inside. You know, back in John 2, Jesus knew what was in man. He said, although they call me Lord, Lord, not everybody gets to go to heaven, even those saying Lord, Lord, because he says that a little later. But here in Romans chapter 12, if I want to please God, I want to give God the sacrifice that he wants, not that I think he ought to have. You know, do you ever ask God what he wants? You know, for Christmas, you know, Miss Shug said something the other day, what we want for Christmas. You know what I told her? Refrigerator. We have a terrible refrigerator in our house. It's a new refrigerator, but it's terrible. So our Christmas year, refrigerator. It's a refrigerator. If she'd have surprised me with a refrigerator, I said, oh, refrigerator. That would have done me some good. If she would have surprised me with enough paneling to do a honey-do list, that probably wouldn't have, I wouldn't have cared much for that. But she asked me, and I was part of it, see? So I got to think about something that would please me. How many times do we ask God, God, what would you like to see? God, what would you like to have? When's the last time you've asked him? When's the last time you've asked God what he'd like to see in your... Y'all right, that's just me up there. I'm speaking in two places. Just pretend I'm speaking in tongues. But when's the last time you've asked God what he wants to see in your life? Or do we just say, God, here, do your best. Here, God, do what you want to do. Do what you want to. Lord, let us bring a sacrifice to you. Look what it says in chapter 12, verse 1. He said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. That you present your bodies. Now, when he gets your body, he gets all of you. He should. He gets what you do, what you like, your wallet, your gains, your goods. Listen, whatever you can do well, God gets that. Listen, if you're a carpenter, God can use you down at his house. God can use you helping somebody that needs help. Listen, if you know how to shoot fireworks, God can use that. When you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Listen, there are things that you are uniquely built for. You realize God needs it? I had a young man one time led him to the Lord. He was going to the University of Georgia on a full football scholarship. Sitting by him on the bench, he just got saved. Face was still wet from weeping, and he said, well, what do I do now, Brother Ray? I said, what do you mean? He said, well, I'm saved. He said, what do I do now? Well, you mean, well, do I need to go to Bible school? What do I do with my life now that I'm saved? He was serious. To him, everything was different now. Can I tell you, the old boy was in church today with his youngest. Serious. Old boy got saved. I said, no. You're uniquely gifted to be where you're at. Take him to Georgia with you. Take God with you. He said, because somebody there needs to know. You present your body a living sacrifice. Is God pleased with your sacrifice this morning? Is God pleased with it? You know, as you're doing this sermon and thinking about all these things, I got 14 pages full of stuff to read, but bottom line is this. I'm going to read this to you as we close. These are the things that God says are important. Look in Galatians with me, chapter 5. These are the things that God says. These are the things that ought to be the fruit of the Spirit. See, if I'm a Christian, this fruit, now it may be green, you know, the tree don't put out ripe fruit. It puts out a bud, then it grows into something else, and then something else. And before long, it's edible. It ain't automatically ready. The same way in our Christian life. You can't go get those tangerines off the tree. First time you see them, you'll be sick. It takes time. Here's what God said that our life ought to be like. Watch this. Verse 22. Chapter 5, verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit, meaning the Spirit that lives inside me, is going to bear fruit. So the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness. Listen to that. Goodness, faith. How about that? Meekness, temperance. Against such of these things, there's no law, meaning there's no way these could, there's no law that can point at these and say that's wrong. Because these are the fruit of the Spirit. When you see these things showing up in your life, it ought to give you great excitement. Because it's putting the very handprint of heaven on your life. That you recognize in your own self that you're part of the kingdom of heaven. And then you can act accordingly. Some of you today may not be saved. Some of you may be. But there's no fruit yet. You say, Brother Ray, who inspects the fruit? God. But he did tell us that we could tell what kind of tree it was by the fruit that it bore. So, what do you do? Well, the Bible says that we ought to try to bear fruit for our Heavenly Father. And I tell you today that if you're not saved, or if you're worried, or if you're not, if ask God where your relationship is. I don't know. This ought to be a service where each person here stops and asks themselves, Lord, how is our relationship? God, how is our relationship? Remember back to when you got saved. Remember back to when God saved you. Do you hear God speak to you? Can I tell you, it's not an audible voice to me. I don't ride down my truck and God sits in the seat and goes, hey, what's going on? Well, that don't happen. But what I can tell you, man, God will impress on my heart. Send somebody a text, or listen, you know, you should act differently in that situation. Yeah, yeah. You say, well, that's just your conscience. Oh, can I tell you, if that's the case, my conscience sure has been a lot nicer over the past 28 years. Because before, my conscience was like, look out, here he comes, you know. But now that I'm saved, it seems to always remind me of things I should have done better. Thank you, God. Thank you. Let's pray. Lord, we love you, and we thank you, God, for this time together. I pray, God, that today people will inspect their own lives. That people will take a good look at the inside and see what's really in there. Because it's what's on the inside that counts anyway. What we do, how we act on the outside is just a sign of what's really in there. God, it's good to see Christians working and doing what you called us to do, Lord. Seeing the fruit of the Spirit grow in their lives. Lord, there's so many people in here I'd like to brag on and just hold them up to you and say, woohoo, God, I see what you're doing in their life. But, Lord, that's not for me to do. That's between them and you. I just thank you, God, for letting me see it. And, Lord, I pray for those that are here that aren't serving you, or at least not serving you where they should. God, I pray that you'll impress on their heart, God, that it ain't about them. It's about you. Help us, God, to be right in your eyes, not man's. I pray for that person who's here today, maybe lost, that's never come to know you as their Savior. Today be a good day to ask you to come into their heart. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would, please stand. If you're here today, you say, Brother Ray, I want to inspect my life. Just come down and pray. Come down and pray. Brother Ray, I'm doing a little inspection today. Maybe you're here and you say, Brother Ray, I've never been saved. Come down and say, would you show me how to be saved? I'll pray with you. And you can get saved today.
I find my rest without you. I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
That song was worth hearing all of it, wasn't it? Amen. Amen. You know, God's given us some good music to listen to. And I've been stuck the past month on gospel bluegrass. I don't know why, but for whatever reason, that's what I'm eating right now. It's good to me. Miss Cheryl and I'm tired of hearing it. But Em's like, oh. But does anybody have a testimony this morning? Anybody have a testimony? It's Pastor Appreciation Day. I sure do appreciate you guys. But, you know, sometimes other people have things they want to say or they want to testify. And this is how you do. This is your testimony. This is how you learn to speak about Jesus in public, is by giving your testimony around other believers. So does anybody have a testimony?
Probably one. Right up here from another
place. We see you. Amen. You know, Miss Cindy said over and over how thankful she was to be at this church and how much Roger loved his church. He was here Sunday rooting on Alabama. They had to win yesterday. But anyway, we're so thankful, and God's blessed us so many ways. Anybody else before we go? If not, Brother Larry, would you dismiss us? And listen, we're going to have lunch back here, so everybody, if you would, please stay. There's plenty. If you'd like to say a blessing on that, please do. And I think I'm going to have to go, instead of being out here, I won't hold y'all up because they'll come get me and tell me I got to go first. So if you would, go ahead.